Good evening. This meeting of the School Board of the City of Virginia Beach is now in session. This is our formal meeting format. At this time, I ask my colleagues and everyone in attendance to please silence their electronic devices and phones. And I ask my colleagues to acknowledge their presence on the voting device. Before we begin, I want to share that Dr. Spence is on annual leave this evening, and in his stead, our superintendent designee to my left is our Chief Financial Officer, Farrell Hunziker. And with the with that, I will ask that everyone join me in a moment of silence. And please rise as you are able for the Pledge of Allegiance. We will now proceed with our public awards and recognitions. Mr. Edwards.
The school board is honored to recognize National Elementary and Secondary Education Act Distinguished School, Rosemont Elementary School. Accepting the award this evening are students, grade level leaders, and school administrators. Let's welcome them. First, Olivia. But please hold your applause until we get all of them out here. That was Olivia Kelly, Omari Rogers, Christopher Hornberger, Madison Retina, Saria Williams, Scales Burkhead, Izeon Peters, Diona Young, Edric Bautista, pre-kindergarten teacher Chanel Jones, and Theresa Holleran. Kindergarten teacher Carrie Zeltman. First grade teacher Katrina Roth. Second grade teacher Robin Cobb. Third grade teacher Laura Chapman. Fourth grade teacher Alice Thayer. Fifth grade teacher Holly Rose. Art teacher Molly Harrison, early childhood special education teacher Maria Sinkregan Berry, assistant principal Penny Fonville, and principal Carrie Hall. Presented by the National Association of Elementary and Secondary Education Act State Program Administrators, this award honors examples of superior schools that have successfully improved education for all students, including those who are economically disadvantaged. Rosemont, which has 65% of their students eligible for free and reduced meals, was specifically commended for demonstrating exceptional student performance. Last year, 93% of Rosemont students either passed or demonstrated academic growth on state assessments. And it gets better in English, and 97% passed or improved on state tests in mathematics. Like other Virginia Beach City Public School schools, Rosemont has also received state accreditation for 3 consecutive years. In addition, Rosemont demonstrates a wide array of strengths, including team approaches to teaching and learning, focused professional learning opportunities for staff, individualized programs for student success, and strong partnerships between the school, parents, and the community. In addition, students work hard. We recognize that all of this takes a team. So if there are staff members, parents, students, or partners from Rosemont Elementary School present in the audience, would you please stand? Congratulations to all. This concludes our recognitions.
Can I have a word?
Yes.
We are Rosemont Eagles.
Born to soar!
Yeah. Congrats.
Hey, Mr. Hunziker, we look forward to your presentation of the superintendent's report.
Good evening, Madam Chairman and members of the board. As you can see, I am not the superintendent. I'm so much taller than he is. But I'm happy to fill in while the superintendent is away. And this month, the superintendent's report is all about you. Governor Northam has proclaimed the month of February as School Board Appreciation Month. In appreciation, the Virginia School Boards Association sent certificates of recognition that each board member will find at your place on the dais. You also got to enjoy some great artwork and take home treats during your recess from some of our very appreciative students. Thank you all for all that you do on behalf of the students of Virginia Beach. And I think you should get a hand. Madam Chairwoman, that concludes my report.
Well, short and sweet. Thank you, Mr. Hunziker. Madam Clerk, do we have any speakers on agenda items this evening?
We do not.
Okay, moving on to approval of minutes. We have 2 sets of minutes to approve, beginning with the January 28th, 2020 School Board regular meeting. Are there any corrections or additions to these minutes? That's the special meeting. Okay, hearing none, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the January 28th school board meeting, Mrs. Manning, and seconded by Mrs. Hughes. Voting is open at this time. Okay, the minutes of the January 28th meeting have been approved. The February 4th, 2020 special meeting with the amendment distributed in workshop. I will entertain a motion to approve these minutes as so amended. The motion is made by Mrs. Melnick and seconded by Mrs. Anderson. Voting is open at this time. The minutes of the February 4th special meeting have been approved. Adoption of the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? Hearing none, the chair will entertain a motion to adopt the agenda. The motion is made by Mr. Edwards and seconded by Mrs. Riggs. You may all vote at this time. The agenda has been adopted. Thank you. Consent agenda. Tonight's consent agenda consists of two items. A, religious exemptions. B, textbook adoption, advanced placement, AP comparative government and politics presented to us last meeting. The chair will accept a motion to approve the consent agenda. Mrs. Riggs and seconded by Mrs. Anderson. You may vote at this time. The consent agenda is approved. Number 12, action. We have three action items this evening. The chair will begin by entertaining a motion to approve the personnel report with the revision transmitted last evening. There were two additional entries on page 4 and the administrative appointments. The motion is made by Mrs. Holtz and seconded by Mrs. Hughes. Is there any discussion? Okay, seeing none, you may vote at this time. The personnel report and administrative.
I did not see the change that came in, so I don't feel comfortable voting on it.
Okay.
I also didn't see the change. So.
Okay, thank you, ladies. And with that, the personnel report and administrative appointments have been approved. And Mr. Hunziker, would you care to announce, please?
Yes, I'm happy to inform you that Mr. Grant L. Baker, who's currently an assistant principal at Kingston Elementary School, will be the new principal at Kingston Elementary School. Mr. Baker is not here tonight and will be recognized at a later meeting.
Yes, and I'll add to that, Dr. Spence asked to defer that so he could personally introduce him, so that'll take place at our next meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
So that leads us to action item B, recommendations of general contractor. We have Kempsville High School HVAC re-roofing placement. And before any potential discussion, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the Kempsville High School HVAC re-roofing replacement. The motion is made by Mr. Edwards and a second by Ms. Owens. Is there any discussion? Mr. Edwards.
I had asked Mr. Freeman and Mr. Arnold to, I alerted him and I was going to, I think it needed to be on action because it's the infusion of $6 million into Kempsville High School, which, given that it's 2.5 decades away from any meaningful renovation, I wanted to make sure that that $6 million was going to the highest priorities. I did mention it to the principal in passing. I did not follow up because I figured that was more of an appropriate staff dialogue. But I did mention to the principal because they have their electrical grid there is woefully inadequate, and they've got a lot of problems that schools of that vintage have. So I just want to make sure. I mean, nobody wants to trade the electrical grid for a leaky roof. I understand that. But I'm not sure what our timeline is for those schools that are a quarter of a century away from meaningful renovation, which is where we sit today. So with that, Mr. Arnold.
Okay. Obviously, the building envelope and having a roof that keeps the occupants dry is of utmost importance, and the vast majority of the existing roof on Kempsville High School is 29 years old. So the bulk of this project will replace what ends up being about 85% of the roof. We're also replacing the HVAC system on in the library and the cafeteria portions of the building. We did reach out and talk to Melissa George. What happened? They have purchased 12 treadmills, and would like to locate the treadmills up in the mezzanine in the auxiliary gym. That was actually the most recent addition to Kempsville. We built, for some of you who have been around a long time, we built a bunch of classroom additions back in the mid-90s, and we built classroom additions at Bayside and Kempsville, which were of similar design, and while we were there, we built auxiliary gym additions. So they would like to put the treadmills up on the second floor mezzanine. And so that requires additional electrical infrastructure. Not that difficult. I'm glad we are asking the right questions about making sure that we check the capacity of the second floor slab to make sure that we can in fact support the 12 treadmills that they would like to put up there. So we've got a way forward electrically to support that. In the event that we have some structural challenges, a backup location for them is in the weight room. What we have found in Kempsville High School is not too different than what you will find in buildings that were built in that vintage in the 1960s. We actually have five of that floor plan, the original Kellum, Bayside, Kempsville, First Colonial, and believe it or not, Kempsville Middle School are all the same footprint. So the challenges are very similar, I talked to Mrs. George for a good while about the infrastructure in the building, and nothing electrically gets in the way of their core mission of teaching and learning. And we're able to plug in interactive whiteboards. If you've been through that building, it's actually fascinating. Where we a couple of summers ago, we ripped all the lockers out. And we installed some what we call apple bars, where charging stations in the hallway. So really, we get requests during the school year from older schools who want to plug things in, and we have a really great electrical shop who deals with these issues on a case by case basis, and the issue at Kempsville High School is not a real significant one from an electrical perspective.
Let me follow up. I mean, as the staff pointed out that as an example, and maybe they haven't communicated all of their issues to their principal. But I was not, I saw the treadmills, but that was not the sole comment about the electrical grid that I got. I do want to say though that the locker rip out and the renovation of the hallways to the hallways look excitingly like Kellum in terms of facilities for students doing 21st century stuff. So I really do appreciate that. And I know the students and staff do. So, and thanks for that update. Sure.
Any other discussion? Okay, you may vote at this time. So the Kempsville High School HVAC re-roofing replacement has been approved. And we have elementary school playground equipment. The chair will entertain a motion to approve elementary school playground equipment. The motion is made by Mrs. Manning and seconded by Mrs. Anderson. Is there any discussion? Mr. Arnold remains at the podium. So,
I just suggest that you, for the purpose of the public, we'll let them know how this program works. Mm-hmm. Is it jointly funded with the city, or do we coordinate with Parks and Rec, and how that works? We don't do this. I mean, we do it every year, but I think it's not a regular item that we talk about. So I think it's important that we all understand how that works.
Sure.
While you're at it, can you add what you're going to be, what's the equipment's going to be? Okay.
Sure.
Thank you.
Will do. To the first question, going back to when we originally installed the playground equipment at elementary schools, really more than two decades ago, it was a partnership in every way imaginable with our friends in Parks and Recreation. We had a 50-50 share on the installation of the original equipment. Obviously, the equipment's during the day is used by elementary school children, but after hours and during the summer and on weekends, it's open. You know, it's open to the public. So, it's another good example of schools are more than schools. They're the center of the community, and it's a kind of a joint outcome. If you look in your capital program, you'll see that there is an ongoing capital project that funds $250,000 a year towards the replacement of playground equipment. Parks and Recreation has not partnered financially. We did hear from the Parks and Rec director that they are planning on including a match in their capital program submission to council, which will allow us to do four, maybe five a year. At two a year, we're going to be at this for a really, really long time. And it's just not, the equipment is old, can't get parts. So we need to be doing more than two a year. To your question, playground equipment has changed over the years, and we're really the biggest change is we are accommodating children that are much younger. And the equipment that was originally installed was installed more for the 5 to 12-year-old age group. So the vast majority of these projects involve taking out all of the old equipment and putting back two different sets, the 5 through 12 age group set, and also the a different set for 2 to 5-year-olds. And we're also partnering with our CSEP friends on that, where there are CSEP programs. I think two of these buildings, Windsor Woods and Lynn Haven, are home to CSEP programs. So you know, you've got three partners, three outcomes. So they're, you know, they're small projects, but they're sorely needed. They're used a lot. And I can tell you folks, we need to be doing more than two a year.
I'll just offer, it's no surprise to anybody up here on the dais with all the focus on recess last year and the progress we made there, that, you know, this is still remains very front and center for all of us, because it is an important component of that.
And the four we did this summer and into the fall at Centerville, Cooper Landing Elementary, PA Elementary, and the last one at Shelton Park, have turned out fabulous. Our friends in Parks and Recreation, Frank Ventures' group, they work together to pull out the old stuff. And so the partnership is great. We need more resources to be able to replace these a little faster.
Are we good? Looks like that. Any further discussion? Okay. With that, you may vote at this time. And the elementary school playground equipment has been approved. Thank you, Mr. Arnold.
Thank you.
Okay. Final action item C, schedule of school board meetings this fiscal year 21 through July, through June 2021. What I wanted to say, this ordinarily would have been approved at the organization meeting. We deferred this component because we did have some discussion at our last workshop, just reassessing the present schedule of the second and fourth Tuesday, and it was affirmed that we would continue with that schedule, and thus we are now in a position to approve the remaining portion of our future school board meetings through. So with that, is there any discussion? Oh, that's right. Thank you. Mrs. Hughes and seconded by Mrs. Riggs. Okay. Here we go. You may vote at this time. And now the discussion. Yes, Mrs. Manning.
Would you just maybe read off the changes for the general public from, did you want to read off, acknowledge the change? There it is. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, I had right about posting it. That was my question to you. I knew I forgot one earlier. Good. So this shares beginning with Madam Clerk, can you share with us what we're looking at here? It's July, beginning this July through the following June.
Right. According to your workshop, you dedicated July 7th and 8th as your retreat dates. And with that, we also have our abridged regular meeting, which is a shorter meeting because the retreat's typically held off of location. And then we have another regular meeting on the 28th. August, there were no changes to what we normally do, the 2nd and 4th. September, we've got a Wednesday meeting because of the first day of school. But then again, we're on 2nd and 4th. October, no change. November, it lends ourselves to being able to have the second meeting in November held on the 1st of December. We have to have a two-week window between the planning for school board meetings. So we're having the meeting on the 10th, and we're following the board's direction to try to have a mid-month meeting in December instead of the latter part when it conflicts with the winter holidays. Also in November, we were trying to avoid conflicting with the Thanksgiving week holiday. So it brought us to a meeting on the 1st and then the 15th of December. And then January, we're back to our normal schedule. February, we start our budget season. We'll begin with a special meeting, and then we have every Tuesday in the month of February. March, we'll continue through our budget season. And then April, May, and June, we continue with our second and fourth Tuesday.
Thank you for that wonderful summary. Any other discussion? Okay, you may vote at this time. And our calendar is approved as noted in the previous slide. Okay, information, under the information portion of this evening's agenda, we will begin with English as a Second Language Program Implementation Evaluation. Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, Chairwoman Rye, Vice Chair Milnick, members of the school board, and Mr. Hansiker. I'm Dr. Allison Bach, a program evaluation specialist with the Office of Research and Evaluation. This evening, I'll provide an overview of the key findings and recommendations from the implementation evaluation of the English as a Second Language program. The evaluation report you received in your agenda materials provides additional details. As a brief background, the purpose of the ESL program is to prepare English learners to be college and career ready through integrated content-based language instruction. The program aims to develop students' English language proficiency so that they will have access to the same educational opportunities as all students. The ESL program is based on standards developed by WIDA, the World Class Instructional Design and Assessment Consortium, and EL-related federal and state regulations. During 2018-2019, 1,545 students received ESL services. They spoke 74 different languages. The 2018-2019 evaluation focused on the program's operation, student characteristics, progress toward goals, stakeholder perceptions, and cost. Surveys were conducted for ESL teachers, administrators, and classroom teachers who taught at least one EL student. Response rates are shown on the slide. As part of the division's Compass to 2020 Navigational Marker Survey administration of 5th, 8th, and 12th grade students, students were asked whether their family spoke a language other than English at home. This item was used as a proxy to identify potential EL students. EL student data were also obtained from the data warehouse, including assessment performance and enrollment data. The evaluation examined the EL student identification, assessment, and placement processes. The first step for identifying EL students is through the home language survey provided to parents when enrolling their child. If a parent indicates a language other than English, the student is assessed using one of the two screeners to determine English proficiency. Students who are deemed to not be English proficient are eligible for ESL services. In 2018-2019, 814 students were assessed on a screener and 70% were found eligible for ESL services. All EL students are assessed through the Access for ELLS test in the spring to monitor their English language development and determine their eligibility for services the following year. Survey results showed that all ESL teachers, most administrators, and 55% of classroom teachers who taught at least one EL student agreed they understood the steps in the identification process. During 2018-2019, elementary and middle school ESL instruction was predominantly provided through the push-in model, where ESL teachers support classroom instruction with EL students clustered in classes. Co-teaching was suggested as it involves co-planning with the classroom teacher. Additionally, ESL teachers could work with students outside the classroom as necessary based on students' needs using the pull-out model. At the high school level, students received ESL services through ESL courses at their home school, which were taught by an ESL teacher. In addition, the newcomer program at Lansdowne High School was opened in 2018-2019 by reallocating ESL resources. To be eligible for this program, students must have the lowest English proficiency level and must have missed two or more years of schooling. This program supports these students as they acclimate to American schooling and culture through daily intensive ESL instruction. In 2018-2019, 20 students received services through the newcomer program. Most ESL teachers, classroom teachers with at least one EL student, and administrators indicated the push-in and pull-out models were effective, while from 63 to 78% of staff indicated that co-teaching was effective. Several respondents commented on the survey that lack of time to co-plan was the biggest challenge. In addition, 36% of ESL teachers and 58% of classroom teachers agreed that the instructional materials available to them were appropriate for the EL students they taught. During 2018-2019, 30 full-time and 2 part-time ESL teachers provided instruction to EL students. When surveyed about caseloads and time, from 35 to 67% of staff groups agreed with the statements shown on the slide. The current standards of quality guideline is 17 ESL teachers per every 1,000 students, which was met by the division overall in 2018-2019. In October 2019, the Virginia Board of Education prescribed new SOQ guidelines for ESL teacher-student ratios based on EL student proficiency levels, which is expected to be voted on by the General Assembly in 2020. A total of 1,545 students received ESL services during 2018-2019, which was approximately 2% of the total student population. The majority of these students were in elementary school. 2 additional groups of students were monitored through the ESL program. A total of 58 students' parents opted them out of services during 2018-2019. These students were monitored quarterly and participated in access testing. An additional 370 former EL students had previously attained English proficiency within the last 2 years and were monitored biannually. Data were also collected to assess the program's goals. The first goal was that ESL and classroom teachers participate in professional learning to understand the needs of English learners and collaborate to seek ways to best serve their EL students. As shown in the first set of bars, most ESL teachers participated in professional learning to increase their instructional effectiveness with EL students, while 22% of classroom teachers who taught at least one EL student did. Regarding effectiveness, 79% of ESL teachers and 81% of classroom teachers agreed that professional learning increased their instructional effectiveness or capacity to teach EL students. Additional data showed that 68% of ESL teachers and 60% of classroom teachers agree that ESL-related professional learning enabled them to meet students' needs. As shown by the last sets of bars, from 8 to 47% of ESL and classroom teachers agreed that ESL teachers effectively collaborated and planned with classroom teachers, and that ESL and classroom teachers collaborated to meet EL students' needs. The second goal was that the ESL program will be student-centered and provide EL students with a variety of choices and opportunities to help students reach their goals. Selected results showed that in comparison to the division, EL students were equally likely to report they were provided personalized learning opportunities and have a plan for furthering their education after high school. However, EL students were less likely to enroll in an advanced course, earn an industry certification in 2018-2019, and meet SAT college readiness benchmarks. The third goal was that the ESL program will foster EL students' social and emotional development to support students as they become confident learners who feel part of their school community. Selected results show that compared to the division, a slightly lower percentage of EL students consistently attended school, while potential EL students had similar perceptions to the division regarding having participated in extracurricular activities and feeling school is a welcoming place to learn. The fourth goal was that EL students will attain English proficiency in listening, speaking, reading, and writing. VDOE provided the required proficiency level gains on the access test for EL students depending on students' current grade levels and previous year's access test score. Of the EL students who had access scores for 2017-2018 and 2018-2019, from 51 to 77% showed the required gains with one exception. 36% of students in grades 1 and 2 who were at the highest proficiency level demonstrated the required gains. The fifth goal was that parents of EL students will be provided with supports and services to enable them to support and participate their child's education. At least 71% of ESL teachers, classroom teachers who taught at least one EL student, and administrators agree that parents receive timely notice of their child's English language and academic performance. However, as shown in the last bars, lower percentages agreed that parents received this information in a manner they could understand. Lower percentages of ESL teachers also agreed that staff communicated effectively with family members and had practices for welcoming EL students and families. The total cost to the division for operating the ESL program during 2018-2019 was approximately $3 million. Staffing accounted for most of the program's cost. Based on the results of the evaluation, it is recommended that the ESL program continue with modifications noted in the following recommendations. The second recommendation is to develop a plan for translation and interpretation services for communication with parents and families of EL students. The third recommendation is to implement strategies to improve communication and collaboration between ESL and classroom teachers. The fourth recommendation is to enhance professional learning related to ESL instruction by expanding opportunities for ESL teachers and encouraging classroom teachers to participate. The fifth recommendation is to expand the availability of ESL instructional materials and resources. The sixth recommendation is to encourage EL students to participate in a variety of curricular options to help them reach their goals. At this time, Dr. Nicole DeVries, Director of K-12 and Gifted Programs, will share the administration's response.
Thank you, Allison. Good evening. The administration agrees with the first recommendation from the Office of Planning, Innovation, and Accountability and plans to address or is already in the process of addressing recommendations 2 through 6. For recommendation number 2, translation and interpretation services, the Department of Teaching and Learning has worked this school year to contract with a translation and interpretation company. To date, we have had essential division documents, ESL documents, Title I documents, and gifted applications translated into the top 4 languages represented in Virginia Beach schools: Spanish, Tagalog, Mandarin Chinese, and Vietnamese. These documents are accessible to schools in the same locations as the similar forms in English. In addition, schools now have access to on-demand phone interpretation services for 170 unique languages. Each school has a unique access code to use when necessary to communicate with non-English speaking parents or guardians. For recommendation number 3, teacher communication and collaboration, the Department of Teaching and Learning is working toward addressing this area of need. In 2018, the ESL model was restructured from being a primarily a pull-out resource model to a push-in co-teaching model. While this is best practice identified in national research and should provide ESL students with a more integrated time with English-speaking peers, The barrier to success with this model has been the inability of ESL teachers to co-plan and collaborate with the general education teachers with whom they teach. At the elementary level, most ESL teachers service students in grades K through 5 across 3 to 5 schools, totaling 24 to 30 different teachers to work with, making it nearly impossible to plan with all of those teachers. The middle school ESL teachers face a similar challenge. While most only travel between 2 middle schools, they are working across all 3 grade levels, and since all 3 grade levels have planning at different times, the ESL teacher is often in classrooms working with students or at the other school for which they are responsible when planning for a specific grade level occurs. This issue is compounded by the fact that student caseloads are significantly increasing, with some elementary ESL teachers servicing upwards of 80 students across 5 schools. We project teacher caseloads to continue to increase over the next several years, as the trend over the past 3 years has indicated a 30 to 40% increase in ESL student enrollment each year. To strengthen the co-teaching model and provide equitable instructional time for all ESL students, Dr. Spence has proposed an additional 12 ESL teacher allocations so that ESL teachers have fewer teachers and schools to work across, thereby easing the logistical challenge for ESL teachers. While this is not entirely a resolution to the issue, it will certainly help. In addition to requesting additional allocations, the Department of Teaching and Learning will work with schools as they plan their master schedules to tightly cluster ESL students in their classes. The tighter schools are able to cluster ESL students, the fewer classrooms ESL teachers have to work between. We will also work to strengthen the co-teaching model by providing opportunities for the ESL teachers and their general education co-teachers to participate in professional learning together, focused around effective co-teaching and co-planning strategies. Finally, we will work with the schools to ensure that all general education teachers are able to access and know how to locate information for their ESL students in their classrooms, including language proficiency levels and accommodations. For recommendation number 4, professional learning, the Department of Teaching and Learning will continue to provide monthly, in-depth professional learning for ESL teachers and has committed to an increased focus on instructional strategies and best practices in ESL instruction, balanced with the focus on state and federal compliance. Additionally, we will continue to provide professional learning for general education teachers in high-interest, high-need ESL topics, and will increase advertisement of these professional learning opportunities so that all teachers are aware of them. As mentioned in the administration's response to recommendation number 3, we plan to provide more opportunities for the ESL teachers and general education teachers with whom they work to learn together how to best support ESL students they serve through a push-in and co-teaching model. The Department of Teaching and Learning is also working to establish a first-year ESL teacher cohort and professional mentoring program to provide targeted assistance to first-year ESL teachers. Likewise, we are establishing a community of ESL educators in which there'll be multiple opportunities across multiple mediums for any teacher who teaches ESL students to dialogue and share ideas. For recommendation number 5, ESL instructional materials and resources. Teaching and Learning has already established an ESL Teacher Advisory Committee to examine instructional resources. This team will vet and recommend resources that support language acquisition at all levels of proficiency and is starting the work by looking for high-quality resources specific to newcomer students. Teaching and Learning will also ensure that general education teachers have easy access to our current ESL resources available to them and their ESL students. For recommendation number 6, variety of curricular options, Teaching and Learning will work with schools, the Department of Communications and Community Engagement, and the Office of Student Support Services to increase English language learners' exposure to the variety of academic, elective, and extracurricular opportunities that are available to them. Translation and interpretation services will be available to for school staff to utilize as they communicate those options to students and their families. In addition, ESL teachers will continue to offer community engagement events and parent workshops specific to their schools and will incorporate information about curricular options into these events. This concludes our presentation. I have with me here today Ms. Kathleen Cahoon-Newchuk, who is our ESL coordinator, along with Shannon Leonard, who is our ESL instructional specialist. And I think we're all prepared to answer questions you may have.
Mrs. Anderson.
So I know that the 12 additional teachers will definitely be helpful. But I have a question about, you mentioned the on-demand phone interpretation services. Is that in use now, currently, or is that something that we're going to be doing?
So that just became available to schools about a week or two ago. So we just finished that working through that contract, and yes, it is available for schools to use at this point.
Perfect, because I heard from some schools that had an influx of ESL students that in some cases, especially when the parents try to enroll them, they were having a problem with, you know, the interpretation of the parents, and parents didn't quite understand, and
sure,
there was no one there to interpret for them. And so that will definitely be a big help for our, especially on our front desk, helping parents as they get their children enrolled. And I'm glad to hear that they're doing more community engagement. I think that will be helpful to get the parents more involved. The more we get the parents involved, the more they understand what's happening. So I applaud you. I know that we have had an influx of students coming to us with English as a second language. In some cases, they don't have English as a second language at all. they are strictly whatever their native tongue is, and so. But we take them and we work with them, and it's amazing how great our ESL teachers are with those students. And I know from my own experience, when you have students come, especially like mid-year, and they can't speak a word of English, I was lucky because I taught the younger students and they caught on so quickly. So after a couple of months, they were usually interacting with the students, and it was so helpful. But the ESL teachers, my hat's off to them, because they really do a great job with our students. I appreciate it. And that's it. That's all I had to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Anderson. Mrs. Manning.
Yes, thank you so much for the thorough report. And we talked a little bit about the budget impact in the workshop, but I'd just like to touch on that one more time. And you mentioned that there are new guidelines being suggested. Is that legislation that's up right now?
Yes.
Is that something that we're following, Ms. Melnick, or?
I certainly can follow it. It was not part of our package.
Okay, So I'm just wondering if I could suggest maybe, you know, if that does get passed and that's going to be budget impact for next year, if maybe we could add that to our legislative agenda to ask the legislature that if they're going to pass these laws, they need to help us fund it.
We certainly will try to do that.
I'm just requesting that it be added to the conversation.
On your request, whether we get the funding or not is another story.
Yeah. I mean, because I'm just looking at these numbers that you're presenting, 500 new ESL students over 2 years, 30 to 40% increase each year. I just, you know, we have to plan for that in our budget. And it's obviously really impacting us right now if we're having to hire 12 teachers to sustain the program. So. Thank you so much.
Ms. Owens.
I have just a couple of questions. Thank you for the report. It was really helpful to get an overview of all the different things we have going on. The newcomer program that's now available at Lansdowne High School, is that something that, similar to other academy programs, buses students from around the city to the school, or is it only available for Lansdowne High School students?
No, you're correct. It actually is available to students across, high school students across the division who meet the requirements to participate in that program. It's not, unlike an academy, it's not, the goal is to have intensive support and then get those students as quickly as possible out to their home schools.
Gotcha. Do we know if we're looking at any similar type program in the middle school?
So that has been discussed, uh-huh, that we have seen an increase in newcomer students at both the middle school and elementary school level. So that would certainly be something that we would like to look into. But again, that requires staffing, and we'll have to see what we can do with that, the 12, sure, if that passes, the 12 additional allocations.
Okay. And then my other questions/comments, I know that we are seeing these exponential increases in ESL students that are difficult to keep up with as far as funding for ESL teachers and programs. I'm wondering if there are any schools that are kind of coming together and providing other supports, whether it's looking at recruitment with their regular staff and taking advantage of some of the staff members in the school who may have other language abilities, just to kind of help assist with families coming in the door and engagement there, or if any of the schools have ESL kind of support, I don't want to use the word clubs, but support clubs where ESL parents and families are able to kind of come together and get information and be a support to each other.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so our ESL teachers at each school are required to provide parent and community workshops that are unique to whatever the needs that they're seeing that their ESL parent and guardian communities have. Twice a year that they're required to do that. So that might vary by school, depending on what the needs are. In addition to that, yes, you're correct. Schools do get creative in terms of making sure that they have, utilizing the staff that they have, who might have those kinds of expertise, perhaps in ESL, but maybe even that just speak another language to help support that language barrier. I could tell you, for example, at Cook Elementary School, they've had a very high ESL population, and they've actually built an entire mentoring program around, which you might be familiar with, utilizing their bilingual police officers in the community. Nice. To provide mentorships to students who are ESL or native Spanish speaking students. So that's been really powerful for them.
Thank you. I'm hoping that the kind of program that they've built at Cook can be kind of the standard or emulated to some of our other schools that have high ESL populations, and that we'll continue to kind of look at how we can use other support systems that are in the school or in the community to support the families, because the ESL staff is spread thin. Sure. And so in the meantime, what we can do to build that up from community resources. And my last thing was, do you know if there is a messaging going out to families in regards to the on-demand phone service? I know that it's probably very helpful for like front office staff when people are enrolling, but when mom needs to call the math teacher, is there a way that calling in, she's able to request that in a way that the teacher can understand and the teacher can communicate back that I will call you back with the translator services, or how are they able to know and coordinate that?
Yeah, absolutely. We haven't worked something like that out yet, but that's definitely a consideration. We do have something that we've begun just this year when the translation services began also, which is for when schools are sending home school-specific communications that perhaps go out to an entire school that are important for parents to know, that we have translated into our top 10 languages, a cover sheet that could go on top of that communication to send home to parents that says, in essence, if you need help, assistance with interpreting this document, please check the box or indicate here, and then they return that, and then they will set up a time for the parent to come in and meet in person with somebody who can walk them through that document, perhaps with the support of the call-in interpretation service. So that's something new we've established this year.
Great. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Mrs. Anderson again.
So this is actually my question. It really had to do with what you just now revealed to us, because one of the things that I was was told by some ESL parents was that they really would love it if, especially if it's, I mean, I know that some of the schools, you can't just say that everything is Spanish, but we do have a higher population of ESL Spanish students, Spanish-speaking students. So in cases in schools where there is a higher population of Spanish-speaking students, it would be very helpful to go ahead and have that, especially if it's a written communication, to go ahead and send that home already translated into Spanish. And so they've asked if that could be done, especially like in a school. I know that in particular Cook, I was told they're about 30% now have. And so it would be helpful if they had some of their written communication, you know, sent home already translated. But that's wonderful that you've already taken into consideration that they can come in and someone will walk them through that. I appreciate that.
If I may, and we might need our ESL director for this. To begin, the other Hampton Roads cities, I assume we have some notion of where, of how we compare with them in terms of this recent influx of students? Do we know in terms of, you know, some of our sister cities, where they?
Good evening. So yes, we do know that Norfolk and Newport News, for example, have experienced an influx. So I know, for example, in Newport News, they've experienced an influx of refugees from Syria and some other countries, just because they have Catholic charities in their city. So yes, we are across the board experiencing an influx of students.
And related to that, I mean, I think it's nationally known that Northern Virginia has probably experienced among the biggest challenges of any region in the country, and it has, with regard to the evaluation or even the recommendations, are we in consultation with any of the school districts up there?
We definitely are. I just recently attended the Virginia EL Supervisors Association meeting last week, and at that meeting I had the chance to consult with some of the other English learner coordinators in the state, including the coordinator from Loudoun County and from Fairfax. So yes, we're definitely taking into consideration their program models and what's working and not working.
I expected that answer, but it's nice to have it confirmed. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Anybody else? Ms. Owens.
Okay. One more and then I'll let us be finished with this. Is there any current or plan to have, I guess, a hub, whether that's like student services, where a ESL parent can go to that one location and maybe they have three children that need to be registered and able to get the service there to assist in getting that done rather than being at three different schools trying to decipher that three different times?
Yes, so we have had a significant communication and collaboration with the Department of Communications and Community Engagement on how we could create something just like that to be able to process students centrally as they come into our school division to register for school, and then perhaps have them be able to test them right there, or not send them multiple places, especially that's a hardship when they don't speak the language. So yes, we've definitely been planning for that to I don't know. Natalie, did you want to add to that?
I was just going to say you'll actually hear a little bit more about that in our presentation on March 10th, because we're hoping that Plaza Annex, once it's remodeled, will be the place that happens. So.
And Mrs. Felton.
Yes. Thank you for that detailed presentation. I know that some of the schools now, like Harlem Elementary and Rosemont Elementary, is really pleased that they're going to get that support as well, because they have been collaborating for the past 4 years with English as a second language with their students and parents. I know Rosemont had a very enhanced program where they brought the children in, and it was like a parent night. Mm-hmm. And they were coming in and teaching the parent at the same time. Thank you so much for their support, and they are going to be really happy about it. But you probably spoken it already, but could you expand on your explanation about cluster classes? Give me the logistics of that, what's really going on in that.
Yeah, so similar to how we would group students with disabilities who are in inclusion classes, or even gifted students, identified gifted students in cluster classes. So they would be, we ask schools to, on each grade level or in middle school at each team, to identify a team or a group of teachers on that grade level who could have a increased focus on the ESL students, so that as the ESL teacher pushes in, they have less teachers to work across, because if every teacher had two or three on a grade level had two or three ESL students in their room, then that teacher in that one, that ESL teacher in that one school may have five teachers to work across in one grade level. So you can see how that could be compounded. And so we ask the schools when they're working on their master schedules to consider how they may group those students together tightly enough that it kind of eases that challenge for the ESL teacher to work across numerous teachers. The other piece to that is that it is a best practice for students to, while we want them to be immersed in the English language, and certainly the more they could be with their English speaking peers, the better. There is a certain camaraderie to being with your like speaking peers as well. So that helps with that as well.
Okay, I think we are done for the evening. Thank you, ladies, and to my board members for their wonderful questions. Okay. Next, we have under information five recommendations from the Policy Review Committee. Welcome, Mrs. Linetti.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Vice Chair, School Board members, and Mr. Hansaker. On behalf of the Policy Review Committee, I'm Cami Linetti, School Board Legal Counsel, and I'll be presenting the recommendations in the Policy Review Committee's meeting on January 9th of 2020. We all are presenting five policies tonight. The first one is Policy 312, Capital Improvement Program, CIP. The only things we are adding here are some Scrivener changes to capitalize words on there, and we're also a reference to the long-range school facility master plan serves as an ongoing resource for the school division's anticipated capital improvement needs. It's just a reference in there. That those are the only recommendations we'd be making on policy 312. Are there any questions? Moving on to policy 316, again, this is also in the business and non-instructional operations section of the policy manual for the school division. This one is titled Policy 316, Local Funds, Virginia Beach Education Foundation Incorporated. As you're familiar, we do have a 501c3 that is authorized by the school division, the school board to operate on behalf of the school division. When reviewing this particular policy, I thought it was important to include actually the mission statement from the Education Foundation. So we are recommending an addition to B1, which is objectives and purposes. The objectives and purposes of the corporation are enumerated as follows, and the amendment would be under section 1. We would now read as 1, to raise public sector support to fund innovative learning programs and initiatives that support the whole child for the students of Virginia Beach City Public Schools and to reward educational excellence. There are a few minor Scrivener changes, additions on that, but that would be the significant change to policy 316. Are there any questions about policy 316? Moving on to policy 317, again, also under business and non-instructional operations. This one is entitled State Funds. We did add some significant wording changes to this one. This is a rather simple policy, and it will now read as policy 317, state funds. State funds, both categorical and general, are based on objective formulas and are provided to Virginia Beach City Public Schools through the direct aid to public education budget in the Appropriation Act. Period. New sentence. The Virginia General Assembly appropriates the funds, and the Virginia Department of Education, VDOE, administers the funds. Funding is appropriated into four major categories, parentheses, standards of quality programs, comma, incentive programs, comma, categorical programs, and lottery programs, end sentence. Those would be the recommendations we would add. We felt this would clarify this particular policy. Are there any questions on this policy? The final policy that we're Policy 318, federal funds. Again, also under business and instructional operations. So just minor changes in that and clarifying projects could also be grants and grantors and some Scrivener's changes. Otherwise, there are no significant changes being recommended for policy 318. Are there any questions on federal funds? Moving on to our final policy, this falls under a different section. This falls under section 4 of the policy manual, having to do with personnel. This one is entitled Conditions of Employment. I think we brought this up to you in prior meetings on there. We've looked around to see what other school divisions are doing and recognizing your procedure for giving annual contracts is not something that generally we a practice that we follow anymore. What we are actually recommending is notification. Once you've been given a contract, you would give a notification of your placement for the following year. So to probably reflect how we're doing that. We are recommending a under policy 475 conditions of employment, subsection C amendment. This is under non-licensed employees. We would take out what was originally listed as paragraph one. We will only have one paragraph, which will now read, all non-licensed employees will be given an employment notification upon hire and will receive annual employment notifications thereafter. Non-licensed employees and with employment agreements or annual assignments do not have a guarantee of employment and remain at-will employees. What you would see then is if you move down further into the policy, we would take out subsection E, which used to be contracts, employment, notification, assignments. We will no longer have that paragraph because the procedure is reflected now in subsection C. That then required us to relabel the following paragraphs, and you'll see just Scrivener's changes after that, relabeling the paragraphs. After that, we'd be removing the editor's notes, but nothing changes significantly. The rest remains as Scrivener's changes. Are there any questions as to policy 475, conditions of employment?
Looks like we're good. Thank you, Mrs. Linetti. So we move on to standing committee reports. Who would like to begin? Mrs. Felton.
Thank you, Chair Rye. I am reporting on my standing committee, but I also like to say earlier this evening I mentioned the 2020 African American Male Summit, and I would be remiss not to mention that the Department of Teaching and Learning was well represented on that day, and without it was a great coming together of a great event, and without their participation, it would not be what it was. I'd also say like that Dr. Parrott, the Director of Office of Communication and Achievement, she is a great and a huge component of this activity as well. And I just like to make sure that we all know that teaching and learning department is there and they're doing their job. And I just said thank you so much for that. I'd like to say that on February the 4th, I attended the Technical and Career Education Advisory Council Committee, and it was held at the ATC classroom at Pembroke Mall. Yes, that class still exists, Pembroke on the Mall, and they are doing great things. Not only are they learning, the students are learning and being prepared for a class to life skills and careers, they're learning to be entrepreneurs. They have their own business within that class to raise money so that they can take their trips on their different achievement award. It was facilitated by Dr. Lockett and Ms. Amy Millison, and they talked a lot about what was going to take place June 4th. And I would encourage you all in the public to try to attend the Trifetic. That includes the robotics, makers of cybersecurity, and the makers expo overview. Our students are well represented in these programs. Please show up. They're really great. They have a large crowd, over 300. It's going to be that grows every year. And I'm always impressed when I attend these programs because the students stand behind their product and what they're building. And I decided to ask you a couple of questions. Did you all know that we have a cyber security range? Do you know about cyber security hygiene? Well, I encourage you to come to the Trifetic STEM program on June the 4th. You'll find out what it is all about. Thank you.
Quite a pitch. Thank you, Mrs. Felton. Mrs. Weems.
Yes, I attended the Special Education Advisory Committee meeting on Monday. And that, of course, is one of our awesome committees, and they are just made up of wonderful parents who have a high level of expertise, but more important, a lot of passion, because most, if not all, of their children have or are receiving special education services in our division. And I just wanted to acknowledge Christina Morrow in the back. It's here from SEAC, and if you've realized it, they're sending someone every month to our meetings. So there's a lot of collaboration between the board and between this with this committee. So we talked a lot about transition, which we as a division have really been working on that this past year. Talked a lot about our transition advisors at all of our high schools, the whole transition process and how we really improved on not just focusing on what type of diploma the student is, but actually the programs, the classes, and how we're going to get the student first to graduate and then into a work, a great workplace. And we talked about our coaches, work coaches, and all that good stuff. And so that led our representative from the Independent Center, and that's on Virginia Beach Boulevard. And that's a center that is for students with disabilities to learn more about skills and transitioning into the workplace. And so y'all try to check that out. And they are actually having a pre-ETS, pre-ETS courses, and that's pre-employment transition services, 4:30 to 6 o'clock on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, March 2nd through March 16th. So again, that's the Independent Center, and that's with an E, Independence with an E, for these students to gain independence with an I. So that's a great resource also out there. And then also, we talked about, they announced that at Corporate Landing Middle School on February 21st from 11 to 1, there's a performance named Cromania, and it's going to be presented in American Sign Language. So that's going to be a great program there. So check that out, February 21st, 11 to 1, performance and pizza. So sounds good. We also Ronnie told us that OPEC had presented at the Children's Hospital on a program, Insight to Autism. And I think that's really awesome because, you know, so many times, sometimes educators and the medical experts sometimes clash, you know, when you're talking about special education, like education versus medical. So again, this shows a way that we're collaborating with CHKD. And we heard that our presenter did an awesome job, so kudos to her. And then lastly, the next meeting is going to be March 9th at Princess Anne High School. Usually meetings, most of the meetings are in the morning, but at that time it will be a night meeting. They try to have two or three meetings at night for working parents. So again, SEAC will meet March 9th, 6 o'clock, and that meeting will be held at Princess Anne High School. We're going to have a speaker, and she's going to talk about sensory issues and how that affects the classroom. So spread the word. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Weems. Mrs. Anderson.
So I attended the CSEP meeting last week and was presented this so that I can give it to Mrs. Weems. It is a resolution that they sent you, and it says, whereas Mrs. Carolyn Weems, board member of Virginia Beach City Public School, has served as a member of the Joint Board of the Southeastern Cooperative Educational Program, CSEP, from September 2006 to June 2019, whereas Mrs. Weems has provided continuing support in developing cooperation among local school systems and guiding the growth of the Southeastern Cooperative Educational Programs, now, therefore, the Joint Board of the Southeastern Cooperative Educational Program, CSEP, the superintendents of Chesapeake, Franklin, Isle of Wight, Norfolk, Portsmouth, Southampton, Suffolk, and Virginia Beach, and the staff of CSEP extend to Mrs. Weems their appreciation for her achievements in fostering cooperation among local school systems and commend her for her contributions to CSEP in furthering the provision of services to children with special needs. Be it further resolved that this resolution be recorded in the January 29th, 2020 minutes of the joint board.
Thank you. Thank you, and it's been an honor to serve with the folks at CSEP, definitely. Really do appreciate it. Thank you.
This is for your transportation.
Thank you for sharing that, Mrs. Anderson. Congratulations, Mrs. Weems. Mrs. Riggs.
I'm going to sound like a broken record, but because the Youth Ambassador Program is really off to a great start with 8 of our students, from 4 from the middle school and 4 from the high school, are participating, and they're competing for that title. It will be on March the 6th at MOCA, and the tickets are $25 for adults and $10 for students, and free for children under 6. But it's going to be a great event. We have some fantastic competitors. They are very talented. So it's going to be really good. So we're going to have a silent auction and snacks and things like that. And our music program from Kellum will be playing and singing. And we have cheerleaders from Tallwood and Cox that will be welcoming guests. So please come out. It's going to be super. These girls, they're all girls because we had no boys to apply. But they are fantastic. It's just amazing to see the talent in some young students. I mean, some the eighth graders from the middle school, which will be ninth grade next year. But they're going to be really super. I did want to give a shout out to the TCE open house that Bev Anderson and I attended last week. It was fantastic. We learned a lot about, we got there late because we had a discipline committee meeting until 7, 6. But we're like, we're going over anyway. And so we got to be able to talk to some of the students because they were coming into the hospitality room. And so they told us about their programs. It was really good. It's just fascinating to see. That building was built in 1970. And David Swanger, the principal, you know, was telling us a lot about it. And it's just, it's been around a year, and I'm telling my age here, a year before I graduated from Coastal High School. And of course, it wasn't available but that one year. But it's just so, such a great opportunity for our students. It just is, and people don't know enough about it. But the things, the programs that they offer to our students, one was the, help me out, Bev.
Dental assistant.
Dental assistant.
A nursing, they have an practical nursing program.
And you don't have to be a student. They can, the nursing program and the dental assistant, they can be adult learners and pay for that program. And it's, and the cost of it's so unique. I mean, one of the girls was telling us that she could not match that cost anywhere. So it's just an amazing program that has so many opportunities for our students. I went a couple of years ago, and I was like, I love going back and seeing that school because it has so much to offer.
And next year they're adding a pharmaceutical program. I'm not sure exactly.
Yes. Yeah, next year they're building a part to the, because he was telling us about it, and they're going to have a ribbon cutting this summer to open that. So I'm excited. Right. Yeah. So I just felt like I needed to give a shout out to that because it's just amazing what they have to offer our students. And, you know, especially our students, not everybody's college bound. And we need these skills that they are providing.
They're training plumbers and electricians and
bricklayers and
yeah,
just mechanics. It's just really super. It's just really loved it. So, and I also want to give a shout out to one of my schools, Centerville, because I went to their special me program last week, and their students that were recognized as special me. It was started because of a teacher that taught there 30 years ago, and after her retirement, I think 2 days after her retirement, she was killed in an accident, and they've had this special me recognizing her and recognizing students that have come, you know, have done something significant from each grade level. So I was able to participate in that and was super. So I want to give Centerville Elementary a shout out.
Thank you, Mrs. Riggs. Mrs. Holtz.
Thank you. I'm mentioning a meeting that hasn't happened yet, and there's a reason for it. I serve on the mayor's disability committee, and the 20th, next week, every year they award awards to people who have distinguished themselves in the community, people with disabilities. And so on the 20th, they will be awarding prizes to four different people. Two of those people are graduates. They're adults now, but their graduates are of Virginia Beach schools. Mm-hmm. I think that's noteworthy. It's at Williams Farm at 3:30, and it is open to the public. So if you can make it at that hour, please come. The mayor, of course, will be there. We also have a Facebook page, And if you're looking for it, it starts with the Mayor's Committee for People with Disabilities. But I don't want to mention the names because I'm not sure they've been announced yet.
Yeah.
But I will at our next meeting. Okay, come if you can. 3:30, the 20th at Williams Farm. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Melnick.
Thank you. The school board discipline ad hoc committee met yesterday. Just to give you an update, we have started sharing our observations from our school site visits. We have started to discuss the select school survey results. Mr. McGee joined us for this meeting and we discussed the discipline hearing concerns from our July 2019 retreat. And the orientation process once students have been expelled from school and their placement at the Renaissance Academy. We were also given the data from the September to December referrals and suspensions, September 2019 to December 2019. So if anyone wants that data, I have that available. Our next meeting is Monday, March 9th at 1 o'clock. And also the legislative meeting is Monday, February 24th at 1 o'clock. And tonight at midnight is crossover. So we'll be watching what happens starting tomorrow and we'll keep you posted. Just if there's anything that's of particular interest to you, please just shoot me an email and I'll make sure that you get an update and, we'd love for you to join us, if you'd like, on the 24th at 1 for that meeting. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mrs. Melnick, for the work of you and your legislative committee. As the chair, I am an ex officio member of the Education Foundation, so I think I would be remiss by not saying that the upcoming Pearls of Wisdom Oyster Roast is Saturday, April 4th at the Oceanfront. And even more time sensitive is the fact that you have until Friday to buy discounted tickets. and then they go up $10 after that. So you can see me or any board members if you are so interested. Any other reports?
I have tickets, by the way, in my purse. If anybody wants to buy any, I have them here with me tonight for the Pearls of Wisdom.
So this concludes our formal meeting. Madam Speaker, do we have any speakers on? Madam Speaker, Madam Clerk. Well, I'll get that right. Yeah.